Morning, good afternoon, good evening, and welcome to AI for Good. My name is Bastian Kost of the ITU, the International Telecommunication Union, and it's my privilege to introduce today's webinar, A Long Way Towards Reliable and Robust Machine Learning, by Matthias Hein, Professor of Machine Learning at the University of Tübingen. ITU is the United Nations Specialized Agency for Information and Communication Technologies, and it's also the organizer of AI for Good, together with ACM, 38 UN sister agencies, XPRIZE, and co-convened with Switzerland. For today's webinar, we will be using the Q&A functionality to create an engaging discussion. And for that, we're counting on your active participation. You can find the Q&A functionality at the bottom of your screen. Additionally, there's the chat functionality, which you can use to communicate with other participants. Please make sure to send your message to all panelists and attendees so that everybody can see your message. And with that, it's now time for me to hand it over to our host, Wojciech. Hi, Wojciech.
Hi, Bastian. Yeah, it's a great pleasure for me to introduce Matthias Hein, the speaker of today. So Matthias is a Bosch endowed professor of machine learning at the University of Tübingen. He is Alice Fellow and has been awarded prestigious awards such as the German Pattern Recognition Award and the ERC Starting Grant. Has also received several best paper awards at conferences such as NIPS or COLD. His main research focuses on making ML systems robust, safe, and explainable. He's also working on theoretical foundations of machine learning and in particular deep learning. So with that, I'm happy to have you, Matthias, and I very much look forward to your talk.
Yeah, thanks a lot for the kind introduction. Let me share my screen. Yeah, so I think thanks also for the invitation. I mean, this has been a great series so far, and and I've really have enjoyed the talks in this year of trustworthy AI. So my talk today is has the title A Long Way Towards Reliable and Robust Machine Learning, which means we are definitely not there yet, unfortunately. And I'm trying to present or give an overview of the kind of research we have done in the last 2 years, but also try to connect it a bit, so to give a more high level perspective to connect it to the current drafts of AI regulation in the European Union. And this is joint work with Maxim Andreaschenko, Max Augustin, Julian Bitterwolf, and Francesco Croce and Alexander Meinke. So, I probably don't have to say this here. I mean, deep learning has now led to great success in a lot of areas. And in particular, it has shown to apparently at least reach human level performance in several medical diagnostic tasks like skin cancer or breast cancer. And this is clearly there are great prospects for the future using this. Yeah, and this is not just a medical area. I just have selected this here as an example, but also clearly in other areas as well. On the other hand, if one looks at the medical sector, then it turns out that actually the transfer into the clinical practice turns out to be actually harder than maybe expected. So, which can have multiple reasons. One reason can be domain shift, right? You train on the data of, let's say, an MRI scan of one hospital, then you try to on another hospital, it does not work. Methods are sometimes right, but for the wrong reasons. They can be biased, maybe just to also bias in the data set. They are often not robust, and they also don't flag correctly the uncertainty. And so that means, as a research community, we can really ask ourselves, so what kind of research problems need to be solved really to build safe ML systems? And I'm clearly not claiming in this talk that I will answer this question. I mean, in particular, since I think that we have to think about this problem more in a much more holistic fashion than we are currently doing. I mean, currently we are solving particular problems like adversarial robustness and out of distribution detection, what I will talk about mainly in this talk, but we have to basically try also to combine all of this to really build prototypes of safe ML systems. And on the other hand, one can, I mean, these systems will come, right? And the question is basically, how can regulatory bodies then ensure that ML systems work really reliable as intended? Yeah? And for that purpose, it's at least interesting to look at the AI regulation or the draft for AI regulation, the Artificial Intelligence Act, which has been published in this year. So it's a draft, right? So it will be discussed and probably become effective maybe in 2 or 3 years. And I'm also not claiming that I've really read all the 108 pages, but what is interesting of this document is the part on high-risk AI systems. And that actually, this is pretty short, or at least the technical part is pretty short. It's just 7 pages. And I think actually that these requirements, or that the requirements listed here, are actually quite well done. Yeah. So I think every PhD student in machine learning, or at least working in let's say trustworthy AI, should actually read through this, because I think that the points they make are very clear and also well done. What is not so clear to me yet is how this will be implemented, because for the notified bodies or something like that, there is absolutely no quantitative statements in this document. So it really then depends on how this will be actually translated into something which one can measure. But let me quickly go through these points, because I think they're interesting. So first point is here, requirements for high-risk AI systems. So for the first article is risk management system. So the risks of the intended system when used properly, but also potential misuse. And I think this is also something which we as a researcher should also think much more about it, right? I mean, we had cases in the past, like deep fake systems and so on, where actually systems had gone out and maybe they should have not been published at all. Then clearly data and data governance. I've summarized this here as awareness of bias in the data, but it's clearly much more. It's also being aware of where the data actually came from, about potential, how much data one actually needs, and so on. Then record keeping, this is also important, so that we keep actually track of an ML system over the full life cycle, and basically also have the measures to detect if basically the system deteriorates. And important now for the talk is basically Article 13 and 14. So Article 13 is transparency and provision of information to the user. This in particular means interpretability, but in particular means also making them aware that the user, what the AI system is able to do and what is not able to do. And I think to some extent, as a takeaway for ML research also, we concentrate most of the time also just what it's able to do, but not what it's not able to do. And human oversight is then important, because a human should be able to judge the output. I come back to this in a second. And accuracy and robustness and cybersecurity will be then important for the second part of the talk. So yeah, maybe the first part is this Article 13, transparency, where the idea is that the system provider has to make clear about the characteristics, capabilities, and limitations of the performance. So in particular, it has to make clear what is the intended purpose, and this probably has to be relatively well defined. And then it has also to be clear what the level of accuracy and robustness, and any known and foreseeable, under basically foreseeable circumstances that may have an impact on that expected level of accuracy, robustness, and cybersecurity. Also foreseeable misuse, and specifications for the input data, taking into account the intended purpose of the AI system. So my translation of this is basically that because ML systems do not have a natural specification as maybe usual software, the ML system has to come with its own specification. Yeah? So what does it mean? So in a classification problem, we cannot say exactly what it means to separate, let's say, dogs from cats, right? That's why we learn that. But in the end, we basically still want to have a system where we somehow try to specify what kind of input data we expect. Yeah? So let's say what kind of image processing pipeline has been used, or what kind of images we definitely don't want to use in our system. So this is one important point, and clearly how this can be implemented. This is then part of the second part. And then there's this Article how's it called? Unfortunately, I don't see it because of the Zoom control. Anyway, here the point is that the user, yeah, this is human oversight. So the user has to fully understand the capacities and limitations of the high-risk AI system, and any signs of anomalies, dysfunctions, and unexpected performance have to be detected and addressed. And so my understanding of what this means is that an AI system has to make transparent to the user when it in particular is operating out of its specification. And because there is no specification explicitly given, the AI system has to detect this itself when it's basically operating outside and then making the user aware of this. So that in particular, then one can override the ML system and not use it. Or I guess for autonomous driving, that at least the car goes over into a safe state. Okay, so as lessons for ML research, I think the assumption which we often make at the moment that the test data is IRD from some data generating distribution is simply not true. I mean, it's not justified in any open world system like autonomous driving, but even in healthcare, where one could argue that often we have a relatively controlled setting, we don't have test data which is IRD, right? Because we can have new diseases coming in, which we definitely have not seen before, or rare diseases which also have not been part of the training set. And therefore, it's very important that ML system flag the uncertainty correctly to the user. And or this can be a combination, an ML system then should also reject decisions on inputs for basically which it was not designed. So the ML system basically delivers is its own specification by then just rejecting decisions on inputs on which basically it should not make any decision. Okay, so how is that connected to our research? I mean, unfortunately, this actually is not working. In particular, neural networks are very much known to be overconfident for out of distribution inputs. So let me just explain here the setting of this figure here. So this is actually from Cypher 10. Cypher 10 is a 10 class data set of certain image categories. Dog is one of them. If you train a normal model that's here called Plane, you get this is well recognized as a dog. The system is also 100% sure. 100% means here this is the probability of the predicted class which the system outputs. But if you now feed in this chimpanzee image, which is actually not a category in Cypher 10, then the system also says now it's 100% sure that it's the dog, which is clearly wrong. Yeah? And this is this problem that neural networks, if trained normally, they are completely overconfident on anything which is absolutely unrelated. Now, clearly, this problem has been accessed, and one of the most popular methods in this area is the method of Hendricks, Masaika, and Dieterich, so the so-called outlier exposure, that's how we operate it often, which actually, what it does, it needs a training outer distribution, which they take to be relatively rich. They use the 80 million tiny image data set, which can be seen as a proxy of all natural images. And then they just enforce during training on this large out of distribution training set, just uniform confidence. Yeah, they basically say that the classifier should say on this outputs, I don't know. And this works actually also very well. So the classifier still is very confident for the in distribution task, that's good. And now on the out distribution, it predicts here 16% only for dog. Note that it's a 10 class data set, so 10% would actually be uniform confidence, which would really mean we are completely unsure which class it is. Yeah, so this is pretty good. But the problem is that, if you just perturb this image again slightly, yeah, just do an adversarial perturbation, then you can fool this outlier detection method again completely. Okay. So in the first part of the talk, I just want to give a justification why this is the case, and then basically talk about different methods how one can tackle this problem. Yeah, this is just a different illustration of the same problem. Here you see this famous two moon data set in 2D, and here color coded is the confidence of the neural network on basically all the whole input space here. And what you can see is that the neural network, I mean, this is color coded 100%, is basically very certain all over the input space, even though you're potentially far away from the training data. Yeah, this is typically then summarized that neural networks don't know when they don't know. Okay, and why is this actually the case? Yeah, a large class of neural networks are so-called ReLU networks. These are ReLU neural networks which just use ReLU activation function or max pooling or any other activation function which is piecewise linear. So that's any neural network which in the end basically produces a continuous piecewise affine function for each output unit of the classifier. And what does that mean, piecewise affine? It means that there exists a finite set of polytopes such that on each of these, so the union is the whole space, and on each of these polytopes, the function is just an affine space. And here you see for a simple neural network, the linear region. And basically, since there exists a finite number of them, some of them have to extend to infinity. And on each of these linear regions, the neural network just behaves like a linear classifier. Okay, and here's basically already one sees the problem, yeah, because it's already known that for linear classifiers, you can make them arbitrarily confident by just going to infinity. And basically here, exactly the same happens. As you go to infinity, you can make the neural network therefore arbitrarily overconfident. And this is then just summarized in this theorem, which we published 2 years ago, so that for every point, basically, under a relatively mild technical condition, there exists some class, and such that for the upscaled point, so you just multiply your input point x with a scalar alpha, you can reach arbitrary high confidence. And as alpha goes to infinity, you basically approach confidence one. Yeah, your confidence means that here we estimate the probability with the softmax function. And unfortunately, this is not even specific to ReLU networks, but this can be generalized to any activation function which is asymptotically linear and bounded. And yeah, just note that this is really the complete opposite behavior as you would expect from a normal classifier. Yeah? A normal classifier, you would say, it should get less confident as you move away from the training data, right? But here's exactly the opposite way. As you move away from the training data, the neural network gets more confident in its decision. Yeah? So it's exactly the wrong way around. And other measures like temperature rescaling, which is used for calibrating neural networks, clearly does not solve this problem. And then one can ask the question, yeah, are we doomed? Are basically all classifiers like this? No, I mean, there are clearly classifiers like RBF networks, which behave well. So basically which they can show even asymptotically as you move away from the training data, the classifier gets less and less confident in its decision. But what it means for neural networks is that we really need to change the architecture to overcome this. And what we did, at least as a mitigation procedure, is what we proposed also in this paper, is that we also inform uniform confidence far away from the training data. But we don't only do this in the fashion like outlier exposure, but we do it even in an adversarial fashion, that we maximize the confidence of the classifier around an out-distribution training input in a certain ball around it, and then basically like an adversarial training, we try to minimize this term. Yeah. Okay, and what would be then the result for our basically introductory example? Again, this method which we called ACID for adversarial confidence enhanced training, again predicts well on the distribution task. It also predicts well on this chimpanzee image. So it's very it's almost close to the uniform distribution. And even if you now adversarial perturb this input, it predicts still is has so low confidence. Now, one could ask, is the problem solved? Yeah, it looks like this. Also, this example I've shown before. Now, if you apply here ACID, now again, the classifier is just now confident on the training data, but as you move away, it gets it's very unsure. Unfortunately, this is not the solution, right? Because the theorem said this always holds, and we did not change the architecture yet. So that means if we just zoom out, right, this white square here is just the this basically part of the input space. Then you see that again, asymptotically, the neural network gets overconfident. So that means we really need provable guarantees that neural networks know when they don't know. Okay. And now I basically jump a bit in time, right? So then we have clearly worked on this. So we had a first paper at ICLEAR last year, where we introduced what we called a CCU method, which basically integrates into the training process. We train not only the classifier, but we train Gaussian mixture models to estimate the densities of in and out distribution, and then combine this into a joint prediction also for the classifier. And this leads to a method which performs basically similar to outlier exposure regarding accuracy and also out-of-distribution detection performance. But one can then show for this method that at least this asymptotic problem goes away. So asymptotically, one can even prove that the corresponding classifier now becomes maximum, maximum uncertain when one moves away from the training data asymptotically. But the problem is that ECCU still has this problem that for closed out distribution images, it can still be by adversarial perturbation fooled. And then we thought about, okay, we want to really get rid of this problem. So because the asymptotic property is one thing, but for practice, clearly it matters most that we get this close out of distribution data correct. And so in this method GOOD, which was a Neurips paper last year, we basically used interval bound propagation, which is a method from certified adversarial robustness, to train a classifier where we basically use an upper bound on the confidence using this interval bound propagation, and we just damp it down on the out distribution data. This then leads to a classifier which again predicts well, also has is on the out distribution image, has good performance also on this perturbate. I mean, you can try to perturb it, it still stays uncertain. And now we can even give a guarantee in the whole ball around this input that the confidence stays small. Now, what you could ask is, now the problem is solved? Yeah, unfortunately, still not, because the problem, and this is in general a problem in all methods for certified adversarial robustness on the in-distribution, it's well known that using certified training methods like IBP yield a significant loss in test accuracy. And this is so significant that one can ask, if is this method then in the end actually useful at all? Yeah, or will this actually be taken up? And GOOD, basically the method which I just proposed, achieves certified adversarial robustness for the out-distribution data without loss in accuracy compared to a normally trained model, but guarantees are only possible for shallow restricted architecture. Yeah, so because the bounds of IBP work really only well if the, if the network is relatively shallow. Shallow means maybe less than 8 layers. And with these 8 layers, we cannot reach any state-of-the-art accuracy. So even if compared to a normally trained model with the same architecture, you don't lose performance, it does not matter because you cannot achieve with such an architecture good performance. And also the other disadvantage was that GOOD has no asymptotic guarantee for out-of-distribution data. So then we asked ourselves, okay, can we actually create a method which combines all the advantages basically of the CCU and GOOD? And the answer is it is possible by discriminating or basically getting rid of trying to certify both, just the classifier, but we basically have now a classifier and a so-called discriminator. And the classifier just does the normal thing as usual. And the discriminator, which is then also trained in a certified manner, is just discriminating between in and out distribution. Yeah, so it's just a binary classification problem. And then we combine these estimates then just for a full prediction for the final estimate for the conditional distribution. Yeah, so we have here an in-distribution part, and this would be from the out distribution. Yeah, 1 minus pi given x is just po given x. And what we assume is basically that the conditional distribution for x given on the out distribution is just uniform over all classes. Yeah, we just assume that out distribution inputs are not related to our classification task. And that's why we have here 1 over k, where k is the number of classes. Okay, and then we basically just train these this certified discriminator using then certified methods like IBP, and train also a normal OD classifier using then a fixed discriminator. And doing this then really accomplishes these goals. So we have no loss in test accuracy, almost no loss in normal OD detection performance. So basically compared to a method like outlier exposure, you reach more or less the same performance, but you now gain the certified adversarial robustness for our OD detection. Okay, and just, I mean, the main part, which is interesting, is how to train this certified discriminator. I mean, given that we have in-distribution samples and out-distribution samples, basically it's a binary classification problem, so we just use logistic loss. So this is the part for the in-distribution. There we have just a normal loss. And here we have the loss for the out-distribution part, where we use an upper bound on the maximum of our output of our discriminator around the point Z. Yeah. So we optimize this here around this point Z in this L infinity ball. And for computing this, we use IBP. Yeah. So this yields this upper bound, and this basically is fed into this objective here. And then you just can do train this in a normal fashion. I mean, the training details of IBP are a bit more complicated than usual training, but it works. Additionally, we also enforce negative, strictly negative weights for the output layer. This will become clear on the next slide, to actually get back these asymptotic guarantees, so that we can say asymptotically the classifier gets maximum uncertain. And yeah, natural question would be, doesn't have this quite negative impact on performance if one does this restriction on the last layer to be strictly negative? The answer is it has absolutely no effect. Yeah, you have no negative effect doing this. Yeah, and with this, in particular with this strictly negative layer, we get now actually back our asymptotic guarantee. So I don't want to go through the detail, but basically it's the same theorem as before. Now just saying that as you move, you upscale your given vector x, beta goes to infinity, then the estimate, the conditional probability goes for all classes towards 1 over k. So we are asymptotically maximum uncertain. And how this weight, how this works is that the negative weights of the detector yield actually that the estimate for the the conditional probability pi given x, that this goes to zero as you move to infinity, and then you combine this in our complete estimate for the classifier, and then because this part goes to zero, this anyway doesn't matter, and then this part becomes here one, and so you get just one okay. Yeah, and this is then basically this asymptotic guarantee. And yeah, just shortly then also how one does evaluate this kind of robust out-of-distribution detection method. I mean, normally what we do usually is we just decide for out-of-distribution detection based on the confidence. So confidence is again just the probability of the predicted class. And then this just is a single feature, and you basically you threshold this, and then this would basically yield the detection. And in order to evaluate then this detection using this feature of confidence, we normally one uses the AUC. And the AUC is nothing else than as an estimator of the probability that the confidence then for an in-distribution sample is larger than the confidence for an out-distribution sample. And once we want to evaluate worst case AUC, so once we allow that the out-of-distribution input is now even adversarially perturbed, we basically have this worst case AUC, where we then just have here the probability that the in-distribution confidence is larger than now the confidence on an out-distribution image, but not just at this point, but even the maximum of in a ball around this point. Yeah. And now, similar to as in adversarial robustness on the in-distribution, now you basically get certified guarantees and you get empirical lower bounds. So we have here now a lower bound on the worst case AUC using basically an upper bound on this quantity, which we can compute using this interval bound propagation. And we get an upper bound on the worst case AUC by just using an empirical attack on this quantity. Yeah? We use, for example, projected gradient descent to optimize, to try to approximately solve this optimization problem, and in this way get an upper bound. Okay, now these are a lot of numbers. I don't want to go into detail here. These are just two data set, two in-distribution problems. And what I just want to highlight is that this is the method, the prude, which I just described. So this has actually the same accuracy as outlier exposure. Yes, you have no loss in terms of accuracy. You have also, now this is the indistribution task. Now we test basically how well we can discriminate this from several out-distribution test distributions. So this has not, these have not been seen during training. And also no hyperparameter tuning has been done on this training. So these are completely new. And then you can see that now the AUC is the same as for outlier exposure. Yeah, so basically you can discriminate them as well as our outlier exposure. But what is now novel is that we have actually guarantees. Yeah, so we have guarantees. So these are really guarantees, and we have also computer using adversarial perturbations. And you see that these are quite close, so they are quite tight. Now, basically, in this way, we have now a certified method, which is really practically valuable, because basically all the other performance measures work, right? There we have no degradation, but we gain in this guaranteed adversarial out-of-distribution detection. Now, clearly, one has to admit, yeah, I mean, this one can see from checking the numbers, that we are still far away from where we want to be, right? I mean, these numbers should be much higher so that we would be satisfied. But I think it's a starting point, and you have to see that the adversarial AOC of standard methods is basically always zero, right? So basically you can destroy all of these methods in an adversarial way. So in that sense, basically having this guarantee is still much better than what we gain actually from a method like OE. Okay, now, so this was the part on out-of-distribution detection, or basically reliable confidence estimation, which I think is an important part for safe ML system. And it's also to some extent listed already in this AI regulation. And so it has to become a part of every ML system, I guess, in the future, at least in any high-risk AI system. The next part is on adversarial robustness evaluation. I also just want to come back to the adversarial to this AI regulation of the European Union. They have also here a paragraph where they say high-risk AI systems should be resilient as regards attempt by unauthorized third parties to alter their use or performance by exploiting the system vulnerabilities. And in particular, it mentions explicitly inputs designed to cause the model to make a mistake adversarial examples. So in this AI regulations, explicit adversarial robustness is required. But just to make it clear for what this means on the interdistribution, you have your, for the adversarial text, so you have your task here, recognition of traffic signs. Original input is correctly classified with high confidence. You add this small adversarial perturbation, you get this image here, and now the classifier changes decision, and it even changes its decision with high confidence. So this is normal adversarial examples. Before, we had it on the out distribution, where basically label does not matter. Here, basically, also the label matters, so you can have untargeted or targeted attacks. Now, so what is the basically state, or why is adversarial robustness evaluation actually difficult? Now, the problem for computing adversarial samples is highly non-convex. Their hardness results have been shown. And also at training time, but in particular at test time, so for the robustness evaluation, we have only a tiny budget, which typically rules out standard optimization techniques. And also, I mean, some defenses are so complicated or have basically an own algorithmic scheme, so that one cannot really just, even, for example, propagate through them naturally. So in this case, one definitely needs also adaptive attacks. Now, the problem is that even 3 years after the paper of Atalia, Kalini, and Wagner, yeah, which was a similar paper in adversarial robustness, where basically they got also the estimated best paper award in 2018 for this, where they showed basically that I think it was 10 methods, 10 defenses, which have been published in also top conferences. They could all break them. Yeah. Now, the problem is even 3 years after this, after we have now also guidelines how to evaluate adversarial robustness and on, we have still non-robust defenses are published in top conferences. Yeah. non-robust in the sense that after the conference, it turns out that somebody can break it completely. Now, the question I have, I mean, in particular, we said that the AI regulation says that, okay, we should also evaluate adversarial robustness. So the question is basically, how should notified bodies, yeah, which basically have to test this, evaluate adversarial robustness of a safety critical ML systems if even ML researchers cannot do it? Yeah. So if even the community itself sometimes fails to do it. Yeah. And so that's why, I mean, not because of this problem, but because the state of evaluation of adversarial robustness was really terrible 2 years ago. Yeah, there was no standardized way to evaluate adversarial robustness, which means that typically until you would not evaluate the adversarial robustness yourself, you could not trust the evaluation of a model. Yeah, which was really a terrible state of a community if basically you don't know if a method is a breakthrough or does not work. And therefore, we wanted to have a standardized way of evaluating adversarial robustness to really not just to break defenses, but also to know which of the proposed advances, for example, in adversarial training and so on, really are effective against adversarial manipulation. So really, which really improve robust accuracy. And reasons for overestimating adversarial robustness are typically that the attacks used with insufficient hyperparameter tuning. Often people don't use very diverse attacks. In particular, the recommendation is always to use white box and black box attacks. So black box attacks, which are typically then not gradient based. The guidelines now say that if you use a more complicated algorithm as a defense, then you should also consider adaptive attacks. So either this is ignored, or if it's not ignored, then these adaptive attacks are not done properly. Yeah, and I'm not saying even that these are done intentionally not properly, but people that just don't know how they should do it. Yeah, and to some extent, we cannot clone Nicolas Carlini thousand times to evaluate all of these defenses. Yeah, this does not work. And that's why we proposed AutoAttack as a standard protocol to evaluate adversarial robustness. And the goal was from the beginning to have it fully automatic, so no hyperparameters to be specified, so that it's completely user independent and still computationally affordable. It uses also four diverse attacks. And I will show in a second that it reliably assesses robustness of defenses across models, data sets, and norms. Okay, before I come to this, maybe just one example how gradient-based attacks can fail. So this is the cross entropy loss. Yeah, here written in terms of log n z, or here in terms of the probability, estimated probabilities, again, using softmax function. And then one can just compute the gradient of the cross entropy loss and rewrite this in terms of the probabilities. And what one sees here is this py, so the probability of the two class. And the problem is that the softmax function, the classifier is invariant under rescaling, right? If you classify the logits, nothing happens. The classification stays the same, but the confidence estimate clearly does change if we upscale the logits. And in particular, if we upscale it extremely, then py will become one. And it will even become one. You could say, okay, this never becomes really one, right? Because this is always smaller than one. But because we use finite precision, this actually becomes really one. And then the gradient is actually zero. And then clearly any gradient-based attack will fail because there is no gradient anymore to improve the attack. And this leads clearly to gradient masking. And that's why here's an example. That's a quite astonishing example where the original attack, this was a defense which claimed to be very robust here, 80% on Cypher 10. It would have been way better than state of the art. And you see actually almost all the gradients are actually zero. Yeah. So this blue line is the fraction of zeros in the gradients and the red line is the robust accuracy now as the function of the rescaling. So this was the original model and then we downscaled it. And now you see that suddenly the number of zeros in the gradients go down and actually robust accuracy also goes to a normal value. Yeah, so this is just an artifact of the model, so to say. And then therefore we came up with this difference of logits ratio loss. which is then invariant actually under all operations under which also the classifier is invariant. Yeah, the classifier is invariant under rescaling of the logits, but it's also invariant under adding a constant to all the logits. And the difference on logits ratio loss is basically then taking the margin loss, which is also called the Kalini-Vark loss, and rescales it in a way that it then becomes rescaling invariant. Okay, and then AutoAttack basically uses so-called AutoPGD. That's an adaptive way of doing projected gradient descent, which I don't have time to go into detail, on these loss functions, uses together that with another white box attack, and in particular a black box attack, which is based on random search. So it's not gradient-based, so it cannot basically have any problems with zero gradients, even if you try to estimate. Yeah, a lot of random black box methods are based on estimating gradients. This is just simple random search. And yeah, so I said already that it's automatic user independent, requires no fine tuning, and it is now available due to recent extension to L1 for these three threat models, L1, L2, and L-infinity. Now, yeah, we evaluated AutoTag on 35 models in this paper, and from recent, I mean, at this point last year, deterministic differentials, and AutoTag improved the evaluation, so that means it led to lower robust accuracy than reported for 34 out of 35 models, and we got an improvement of larger than 10% in over a third of the cases, and larger than 25%, which means effectively that the models are broken in 8 cases. And yeah, AutoAttack really reliably assesses robustness without hyperparameter tuning, and to some extent it has now become the method of choice for evaluating adversarial robustness. But we had to learn, and that's why I have this slide here, that also, similar to what I said before, that one has always to be aware of misuse. Also, AutoAttack can clearly be misused, right? And this has actually happened in the past, and has led to wrong claims of adversarial robustness. And that's why I actually introduced flags on AutoAttacks which prevent the use of AutoAttack when it should not be used. Okay, and so, for example, for randomized defenses, we made never a claim that it works for randomized defenses. We had actually a section in the paper where we discussed randomized defenses, and there is an actual flag for this in AutoAttack. So that's why we now detect if some parts of the classifier are indeed random, and then output a warning that actually this different version using this expectation over transformation method should be used. Then we also do an input check. This is not so interesting. We also check if we have zero gradients. So if the gradient is zero for any image, this can happen due to, for example, input quantization or other components of the network which do not allow backpropagation. Then we also output this flag, which says that the evaluation can be unreliable. And then this flag here, square attack improves robustness. For that, you have to know that we do the attacks in a sequential fashion. We do first the cheap attacks, and only the points which are not already successfully attacked, we attack using then the next attack method. The square attack is the last one because it's the most expensive. And our empirical observation was that if square attack still improves robustness, this is a clear hint that the robustness is overestimated, or can be a hint that the robustness is overestimated. And yeah, optimization inference time, that applies to a lot of recent methods which do test time optimization. And again, AutoAttack is not designed for this. I mean, one can use it, but it probably, there is the potential that overestimates robustness, and one should definitely use adaptive attacks in this. And just to show how this then works, these flags now, I mean, actually the flags are currently only raised for one real model. So this was a model from IKEA 2020, which reported 52.4 robust accuracy. The normal version of AutoAttack reduced it already to 18.5, but then this flag is raised that square attack still improves robustness. So what normally would do now some adaptive attacks, we just ran square attack, the random black box method with more budget, so to say, and this then further reduced the robust accuracy. And we did not try to further reduce it because, I mean, so to say, broken is broken. So if it's 0% or 7%, it does not matter in the end, so to say. Okay, Then also, I just want to highlight that we introduced a robust bench, so which basically is a leaderboard for adversarial robustness, which uses a standard evaluation using AutoTag. In particular, it has this model zoo, which now features over 100 state-of-the-art robust models. And it also allows to quickly benchmark new models. And you can test a lot of things on these models. In particular, clearly, you can also test your new attacks on a lot of different robust models, in particular state-of-the-art robust models in an easy fashion. And there have also been other interesting takeaways already from the analysis of different robust models. Okay, so I think I should come to an end. So in principle, clearly these, as I said, these are all just single aspects of what we would assume a safe ML system has to satisfy. And we really need to combine all these properties. And in one paper last year, we at least tried to do this in a partial way. So by just doing adversarial training on in and out distribution in order to get basically a model which is then adversarially robust, it still is accurate. And actually we have these are some outdated numbers. We have now a model which has 94% accuracy on Cypher 10, which is pretty high already, and 80% robust accuracy. So the gap is really getting closer. And reliable in the sense that low confidence on out-distribution inputs, even when they are adversarial perturbed, but also normal out-of-distribution detection performance, and explainable. Yeah, and this is explainable is just actually an observation by Matri's group that when you have an adversarial robust model, then basically manipulating it even over for larger radii leads to so-called counterfactuals, which are actually meaningful in the sense that the classifier itself becomes to some extent a generative model. Yeah, and this I just want to illustrate here for our model actually. So what you do is basically in order to compute such a visual counterfactual, you do a targeted attack on the confidence. Yeah, so you maximize the confidence or estimated probability for the target class T in a certain budget around the given input point X. So this original image is, for example, misclassified as BERT. And so here in this row here, we enhance the decision into monkey. And in this row, we enhance the decision into BERT. And you see actually that it works pretty nicely and produces features which then clearly let it recognize as monkey or BERT. Now, the problem is that for out-of-distribution inputs, and here we compare them to a normally adversarial trained model, because adversarial trained models are not out-of-distribution aware, they produce already quite high confidence. This is restricted image net, I should have said this, already high confidence here. Until then, if you try to do this targeted attack, then actually they even without, I would say this is not definitely not a dog, but they are very sure that it's a dog. Whereas our out-of-distribution aware classifier at least increases confidence, let's say only if at least class-specific features have appeared. But, I mean, one has to be honest, I mean, this is still the confidences which we assign here are still much too high, right? This is still not what we would expect really from a reliable method. So that this shows that there's still a lot of work to do on these images, which are natural images. Yeah. Okay, I think I make this very fast. So this part was just, here we did semi-supervised learning. Semi-supervised learning is unfortunately often done actually in a closed world setting, which for most semi-supervised learning settings makes actually no sense because we want to use large data sets where we have not really control over if they come all from the classes which we want to train on. So an open world setting makes in semi-supervised learning much more sense. But if you apply actually established semi-supervised learning, so state-of-the-art methods in an open world setting, they actually would pick up completely the wrong concept. Yeah, so they think that certain objects belong to the classes, which leads them basically effectively to a distribution shift. and is really a problem for AI safety. And you cannot see this if you just evaluate test accuracy. In test accuracy, these methods are still improving over the normally trained model, but they have a complete distribution shift. And even here, there's a competing method, which is actually distribution aware, but it still has a lot of mistakes. And I think applying these classifiers then in the wild would basically lead to a complete failure. And we do a very careful selection and using again out of distribution aware methods, and that leads then to a selection of new points which are supposed to be classified in a self-training manner, which is very reliable. Okay, so let me conclude. So I think adversarial robustness, at the moment the community has really to ensure that all new defensive, in particular the one using stochastic or optimization components, are evaluated by a strong adaptive attacks. In order to avoid this fallback, what I call always the dark age of adversarial robustness, yeah, where basically the evaluation was done properly, so that we really have to get this fixed. We need really reliable systems, and what this means for us is that that ML systems have to implicitly provide their own specification. So in particular, they have to be out distribution aware, and the confidence which we assign to the predictions has to be reliable and sound. And in particular, this has to hold also for classes which are semantically close to the in-distribution task. So for example, and this is clearly still a very hard problem, for example, we cannot really distinguish, let's say we train on a certain task, a set of diseases. Now a new disease comes in, which is basically similar, semantically similar to the existing diseases, then it's very unlikely that we will be able to detect this with an AI system. And in order to overcome this, I think we really need a more holistic point of view on this. So the community needs to redesign benchmarks where the ML aspects of safety are tested simultaneously. So accuracy, robustness, explainability, calibration, fairness, and not just the individual aspects. So I think we really have to get here further on and really try to incorporate all the safe ML aspects into one system. And last, I think that we also need tools for the evaluation, because notified bodies will need reliable tools to automatically assess properties like, for example, as adversarial robustness, as it's very unlikely that they can develop such tools all on their own. Yeah, thanks a lot for your attention.
Yeah, thank you very much for this very interesting talk. So now we have time for Q&A, for questions. Do we have questions from the audience? So maybe I will start with one. Do you think a lot of these problems which we are observing comes from the fact that we are training discriminative models? So would we, if we would use more generative models, would we get rid of some of these problems, or that does these robustness issues also are independent of that?
Well, in principle, I would say it should, we should get rid of these problems, because clearly one of the problems in classifier is that we are just modeling PY given X, but we're not modeling PX, right? So, and if we would model P of X, then we would model the whole probability distribution and the problem would be gone. Now, that said, the problem is that generative models currently suffer exactly from the same problems as classifiers, right? This has been shown that they are also overconfident on inputs which are not from the distribution they have been trained on. So I think in this regard, it is definitely the way to go, but it would not fix the problem at the moment.
And this overconfidence issue, does it also depend on the dimensionality of the input, or where does the dimensionality of the input kicks in? Does it make a difference?
Apart from clearly that estimation of densities of something like this in high dimensions, that this is extremely difficult. Their dimension definitely plays a role. We also know that atmospheric robustness is clearly in higher dimensions much more difficult than in lower dimensions, or this problem almost does not exist if you have extremely low dimensions, like below 10, then basically you have not this problem. And this really comes only up if you do image classification with dimensions in the thousands.
Do we have questions from the attendees? So maybe I will have another one, which I always ask to our speakers. So what do you think? The approach which we are currently, like these neural networks are doing, it's like mainly bottom up. So you give it an image, pixel values, raw pixel values, and then you get its process and you get a prediction. But this is not how we humans, like, how human perception works, right? So we have some bottom-up processes, but we also have some top-down processes where we kind of interpret what we see and also like compare it to what we know. We have some world knowledge, and therefore we are not so easily fooled by, say, a sticker on a stop sign. We still know that this is a stop sign because we have some kind of extra knowledge and have some process which kind of, controls our perception. Do you think we need something like that also, like in the area of machine learning? And do you see any potential ways to go there, potential paths?
Yeah, it's a good question. I agree that we could probably rule out a lot of things which happen at the moment due to just picking up spurious correlations in the data by having some argument about arguing that certain, let's say, attributes or whatever have to be present, and they have to be even present in a certain geometric configuration, that we would say that this is now some object. I think that would already help. We have not tried that yet. I think that would be definitely a reasonable path. I think why probably people don't try it is that this would then you have to again manually define what this means. You have to say there exists this geometric configuration. On the other hand, I guess we will anyway not find a solution. I have given up on that. I think that there is a solution which will fit all purposes. Yeah, I think this does not exist. And I can really imagine that for certain well-defined tasks, this is definitely a way to go and what would lead to much better results than what we currently have. In principle, higher level reasoning is definitely a very interesting area, but I have not followed this area very much, so I'm not aware of what unfortunately what the current state there is.
We have a question from the audience. Would Bayesian neural network be able to express uncertainty when confronted with adversarial attacks?
Oh, good question. So first of all, Bayesian neural networks suffer actually also from this overconfidence problem. We had also a work with Philip Hennig together on this, and also tried to, had a method to fix this, at least partially. So Bayesian neural networks per se are not better than normal neural networks, I would say, in this regard. I'm not aware actually on adversarial attacks on Bayesian neural networks, but I don't see any reason why they should not work.
Yeah. Follow-up question, like how would adversarial attack on one stochastic realization of a Bayesian neural network confuse another sample of the same Bayesian neural network?
That's why for all randomized defenses, one uses this expectation of transformation. So you do that several times and then you average. And In this averaging process, you basically then gain again the information which you need, which you don't have in any sample separately, and then you can typically attack these. For example, we attacked in the original auto attack paper from last year. We attacked this an energy-based model, and this was relatively easy. There was absolutely no problem.
Mm-hmm. And what is your opinion about like redundancy? Because I think many technical systems, redundancy is one way to gain robustness. Would it help also in machine learning to have
I think definitely. I think for a lot of systems, redundancy is important, or that you at least feedback what the other modality has estimated and see if this would actually make any sense with another sensor and so on. That definitely makes a lot of sense. There's unfortunately little work on this, that is. If I would build a reliable, object detection systems for cars, I would definitely use this redundancy in the sensor information. Mm-hmm.
So do we have any other questions? So like last chance. So if not, then I would have a last one. So what do you think? I mean, recently people show that you can also design attacks on explanations, that you can design adversarial examples which lead to the correct predictions, but which fooled your explanation. Can you apply some of the techniques you presented to there, or are you working towards this direction? What is your opinion on that?
I have to say, when these first papers came out, which showed that you can fool saliency-based methods or whatever, I found that not very interesting, because I thought it's super obvious that this should be possible when we can also fool classifiers, or we can even fool classifiers and some detection method together. So it was just getting more complicated, but it was not, I mean, the principle was exactly the same. So we are not actively working on attacks on explanations. I mean, we are working on these counterfactual explanations, which work also actually only for adversarial robust models. And we have not tried attacks on them. But I would be relatively sure that you cannot attack them. Yeah, so that the explanation or the counterfactual would not change, or you could not change this much in an adversarial fashion. I'm pretty sure. But this is now a statement which is not. We have to see.
Interesting. Okay, so thank you, Matthias, again. It was a wonderful talk. So thank you for being with us.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Samik.
Thank you, Wojciech, and a big thanks also to our speaker, Matthias Hein. We're going to we hope you enjoyed the webinar today, and we're going to launch a quick poll that you can express. And in the meantime, let me mention a few things that may be of interest to you. So on Monday, we have, as part of AI for Good, the AI for Health in Developing Countries seminar with Hugo Morales, co-founder of RoboLaura. Next Wednesday, together with IAEA, the International Atomic Energy Agency, we have AI for Nuclear Energy with Jacob Lee, the Director of the Standardization Bureau at ITU, and Mikhail Khudakov, the Deputy Director General of IAEA and Head of the Department of Nuclear Energy. Thursday at 4 p.m., we have the next installment of our Trustworthy AI series, Trustworthy AI Through Law, Current Proposals to Regulate Artificial Intelligence, with Christian Jeffel, Assistant Professor at the Technical University of Munich. You can find more links and information in the chat. And with that, we have reached the end of the webinar. And I would once again like to thank everyone, our host Wojciech, our speaker Matthias Hein, you, our participants, our partners, sponsors, and our co-convener Switzerland. Rewind selector. Rewind selector.
Rewind selector. Rewind selector. Rewind selector. Rewind selector. Rewind selector. Rewind selector. Selector. Rewind selector. Rewind selector.